cartridge-based lockout chips. We first saw Nintendo utilize these all the way back in 1984. Known as the 10NES, we covered this chip and its history in a previous episode. But to summarize, a simple lock and key methodology was used to mitigate any unlicensed bootleg games on the system. With two identical chips, one installed inside the console and the other in the cartridge, they were used to lock out any unlicensed or different region games. Although it was possible to disable and circumvent this chip simply by cutting a pin from the chip, the code inside the chip was intact, and this method wasn't foolproof, and of course you would need to void your warranty. In fact, the 10NES took over 20 years for it to be cracked. It took even longer on the Super NES. Nintendo used almost the same 10NES chip on the Super NES. I say almost because although it was a variant of the same chip, it wasn't identical, it ran a different set of code. This meant that the reverse engineering efforts on the NES would not help. Just like on the NES, the Super NES had its own variant of the 10NES lockout chip, known as the CIC. It had a different set of instructions and a different set of code. And really, on the Super NES, the chip was mainly used for region locking of games. But this only really represented the first line of anti-piracy on the Super Nintendo. As we'll see, more sophisticated anti-piracy techniques needed to be developed. During the heyday of the 16-bit Super NES and Sega Genesis days, disc copiers started to become very popular. A disc copier is essentially a device that plugs into the cartridge port and has its own firmware. It also includes a built-in disc drive, the same that you would find on a PC, and this would allow you to simply insert an original cartridge and you could dump the contents on the disc. It also allows you to play games directly from the disc, completely bypassing the need for the original game. You can also back up and restore save files. These disc copiers were essentially tools for piracy, based on copying being very popular on other 16-bit platforms like the Amiga and the Atari ST. The most well-known disc copier for the Super Nintendo is known as the Super Wildcard DX2. This was the Swiss Army knife of copiers and allowed you to do almost everything. But unfortunately, this form of piracy meant releasing cracking groups started to get involved. Super NES games, just like others, were dumped and released and spread around the world on bulletin boards and FTP servers. As you can imagine, Nintendo was not thrilled. On the NES, there was bootlegging, sure, but disc copiers weren't really a thing back then. On the Super NES, they were affordable and easy to get, and you could buy a box of floppy discs very cheap. Nintendo was worried about people renting their games, copying them, and returning the originals. In 1994, Nintendo bought a 25% stake in Rare and became a second-party developer. Nintendo's partnership with Rare was extremely important to both companies. Rare had the experience with making quality games, and their new secret weapon, Silicon Graphics technology, was about to be utilized in their up-and-coming games Donkey Kong Country and Killer Instinct. To stop disc copiers, both Killer Instinct and Donkey Kong Country would lock the game out if it knew that a copier was attached to it, or if it had loaded a ROM from floppy disk. It would present an anti-piracy message that looked like this. Nintendo also started to introduce the same anti-piracy features in other games like Earthbound and Super Punch-Out. This meant that the games needed to be cracked. Owning just a disc copy wouldn't work. You also needed to patch the ROM. So how does this anti-piracy actually work, and how does it kick in? Any Super NES game that requires a save has what's known as SRAM or save RAM. This RAM is usually quite small in size, maybe only 8 or 16 kilobytes in size depending on the game. It's built into the cartridge and connected via a battery. If the battery dies, you lose your save games. Disc copiers, on the other hand, have a much larger amount of SRAM because they want to ensure that they can manage and handle any size save file possible, and this is how the games are checked. Because any particular game knows how much SRAM is needed, it simply checks to see how much SRAM has been allocated to whatever is in the cartridge, and if it's any different to what it expects, it will display the anti-piracy message and lock up the game. So, let's go ahead and see if we can trigger an anti-piracy message on the Super NES, and the best way to do this is to use an emulator such as SNES 90X. With an emulator like SNES 90X, I downloaded the source code and compiled it up on my PC. So let's go ahead and fiddle with the SRAM. In the memory class, this is the function where the SRAM is calculated from the ROM, and this is where we can hijack the SRAM value. I'm going to give it a size of 64 kilobytes, which is way larger than normal. Let's go ahead and see what happens. Running the emulator and loading Donkey Kong Country, everything seems to work fine, but as soon as you load a level, it indeed shows us the anti-piracy message. And just to prove that this is not a fluke, this also appears in Donkey Kong Country 2. If we go ahead and load up Earthbound, it displays a similar message. In fact, SRAM anti-piracy checks were introduced in late 1994. There's only around 12 games with this anti-piracy check, with most resorting to the lockout chip.
The SRAM check method against a disc copier was one way that Nintendo was able to circumvent piracy, but Nintendo didn't stop there. They came up with more ingenious ways to beat the pirates.
Donkey Kong Country 2 was one of the first Super NES games that introduced multi-layers of anti-piracy. The CIC region lockout and the SRAM checks came first, and incidentally, if you open up the SRAM save file that DKC2 creates, it leaves a nice little message knowing that you've tampered with the game with the words "a pirate" embedded in the code. Nice one. Another check was to test the registers of the main CPU, the 65C18. In theory, if these registers are set to their default values during boot up, then it's assumed that an original cartridge has been inserted. But if they are different than expected, it's assumed that a copier is connected and potentially running its own code. There are some additional RAM tests as well to check for copiers, which also has CRC or checksum validation. If this check fails, the memory address location 0AFD in hexadecimal, which contains a count to the total number of screens for a level, is reduced by 1. And to test this out, let's go ahead and use Donkey Kong Country 2 and a SNES 90X emulator. By hijacking and patching the memory location 0AFD in hexadecimal and reduce the number of total screens count, you can see that this character is completely boxed in. This means that this level will stop scrolling and the end of the level can never be completed. There's also a reset vector check. A reset vector is essentially a pointer to a section of memory where the game boots from. Reset vectors are modified if there's a cracktro, trainer, or intro that was injected into the ROM. If this was modified, the game will have weird behavior, like barrels not breaking or being randomly kicked out of a level back to the map and not being able to proceed. Donkey Kong Country 3 also took these features and added a few more. And of course, none of these stopped expert crackers from dumping and patching the game, but it certainly made their life a lot harder.
So, if there's one game that stands out in the entire Super NES's library of devious anti-piracy methods, the one that really comes to mind has to be Earthbound.
Earthbound is a role-playing game known as Mother 2 in Japan. It was released in North America in 1995, right in the middle when disc copying was running rampant. The story follows Ness and his friends, traveling the lands, getting into adventures, leveling up to ultimately defeat the end evil boss, Gygas. No one really liked Earthbound at launch in North America, with lukewarm reviews and sales, but the game is now a cult classic and one of the most sought-after and expensive Super NES games around. Earthbound implements four levels of copy protection, each more devious than the one before it. Like Donkey Kong Country, regional lockout and SRAM checks are in place, but any cracker worth their salt can easily patch both of these out when they dump the ROM. But the Earthbound developers detected for these patches. By all accounts, the game appeared to work, and you could play and save your progress just fine. But the game's enemy encounter logic was amped up significantly, and there was a ton more random encounters than usual. These encounters on the beach, for example, hardly ever happen in the real game, and encounters often occurred in places where they normally wouldn't, with the game almost becoming unplayable as is. But then there's one last middle finger to the hackers and those that are playing a bootleg version. If you get to the last boss, Gygas, during the battle the game freezes. The screen turns black, but the music continues, and when you reset the game to reload your saves are completely wiped clean. This is also easily tested on an emulator like SNES 90X, and surely enough, it works. There are other Super NES games that have anti-piracy measures like this, but in the end, without any form of encryption on the console meant that the hackers would always find a way. Nintendo stopped the casual disc copying, but they couldn't prevent the experts from patching the code. Still, removing a save game right at the end is one of many methods to mitigate piracy, by letting the cracker think that he's defeated the anti-piracy when clearly he has not. And finally, going back to the CIC lockout chip, the Super NES variant of the chip was finally completely reverse engineered in 2010, with the Super CIC mod, a way to play all region games, being released.
So there you have it, guys. So that's the story of anti-piracy methods on the Super NES. It's a fascinating topic, and Nintendo really took things to the next level with some of their games. They really wanted to protect some of their IPs. And, you know, they were successful in doing so from a casual copying standpoint, but obviously with the disc-based copiers that were out at the time and the ability to quickly patch ROMs and really just remove any type of protection or any type of checks in the ROMs themselves, it meant that ultimately these games were quickly dispatched and defeated. Now we're going to take a look at the Nintendo 64 in an upcoming episode because there's some more interesting stuff to talk about there as well. But I'm going to leave it here for this video. I hope you enjoyed it. As always, if you liked it, leave me a thumbs up and let me know what you thought about it in the comments below. As always, don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye for now.